Why are we still talking about masks in 2023? Why is this even important? Well, pandemics, whether due to influenza, COVID-19, or other viruses, happen periodically. And if we don't have a definitive answer on whether masking is helpful for these viruses and in what situations, the general population may be mandated to wear masks when they're not actually going to be beneficial. Today, I'm going to present the best data we have here on medicine with Dr. Moran. I'm Dr. Keith Moran, a consultant in internal medicine. I want to present two Cochrane reviews. Now, Cochrane reviews are considered one of the best in evidence-based medicine. The medical community considers them to be the gold standard due to their methodology, thoroughness, and transparency. Now, despite this, both of these systematic reviews were heavily censored. Now, they looked at properly done randomized control trials in their research, not observational studies. Will these reports finally give us some definitive answers on masking? My main focus today is a recently published January 30th, 2023 systematic evidence-based review from their library. As always, there's a link below to the document in the description. There's also a link to their November 2020 systematic review. First, I need to mention that their review, which was published in November 2020, was actually delayed for 7 months. And this 7 month delay is important because it was at this time where governments were making policy decisions on what to do with the pandemic, specifically looking at the non-pharmaceutical interventions such as masking in order to try to prevent COVID-19 infection. It did not contain any COVID studies, but it points out that there was moderate certainty of evidence that wearing a mask probably makes little or no difference. No statistical difference, that is, to the outcome of laboratory-confirmed influenza compared to not wearing a mask. This was based on 6 randomized trials of 3,005 participants. They stated that harms, meaning harmful effects of masking, were rarely measured in the studies and they were poorly reported. They also looked at 5 trials, also randomized, of 8,407 participants using the N95 and compared them to a surgical mask. And again, there was little or no difference. In other words, no statistical difference. For hand washing, they pooled randomized data of over 61,000 participants. Now here, they demonstrated a statistically significant 11% relative reduction of a respiratory illness. Now they were ready to publish this in the spring of 2020, according to the lead author, Tom Jefferson. But the heads of Cochrane actually held this publication up for 7 months before it was published in November 2020. After this, they found themselves being censored. They were censored by social media companies, and here's an example of this on Instagram. It was very troubling for me to see this happen. Censorship of physicians and medical researchers, including myself, has been present throughout the pandemic. Calling the Cochrane's research to be misinformation when it's clearly high-quality evidence-based information is just not right. Many countries were convinced by non-randomized, flawed, biased, observational studies to create mask mandates with the perception that it had to do with appearing as if they were actually doing something. But if you're going to do something, you want to do something that you know is going to work based on evidence. That's how we do it in medicine. Now, unfortunately, good quality randomized studies with masks to prevent COVID should have been done. I've talked about the 2 main randomized studies for masking in the general population in other videos. The bottom line is that the Danish surgical mask study showed no benefit. And the Bangladesh study showed no benefit of a 3-ply cloth mask and marginal benefit of the surgical mask, although subsequent review of the data demonstrated that the randomization in that study was not ideally done, so there was some degree of sampling bias. So you saw medical experts initially at the beginning of this COVID pandemic saying masks were not helpful. And of course, this was based on the high quality data that the Cochrane collaboration had previously reviewed. Then subsequently, they flip-flopped in many countries, leading quickly to strong recommendations for masking, then mask mandates, all in the absence of good quality randomized control trial evidence. All of this, of course, was been done without proper studies. Recommendations to mask a 2-year-old or the 6-feet-2-meter rule, that's not based on any evidence. Certain situations did not make a whole lot of sense, of course. such as walking into a restaurant with a mask on, but then taking it off to eat. And of course, wearing it on a plane, but taking it off to drink and eat. Masking young kids in daycare, but then allowing them to take their masks off for their naps for an hour or two was another of many examples. My last example, I'm not suggesting that young children should wear them while sleeping, but many in the general population found these sorts of things to be very hypocritical, and rightly so. It's very difficult to force people to do things when there's no evidence, and that's why you saw a lot of resistance from the general population. Some people will say that the absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. But in the Cochrane review, as I will review, we've got evidence, albeit perhaps not as robust as we all might like. But this is simply because research around the world was severely lacking and the people that should have promoted the research did not. This is one of the many pandemic mistakes that I highlight in my video, the top 10 pandemic mistakes, which I made quite a while ago, last year actually. Now, talking about the Cochrane most recent review of January 30th, 2023, again, they only looked at randomized control trials here, and they were investigating physical interventions for COVID-19. And in their review, they didn't look at any observational studies. And of course, the problem with observational studies, and you see a lot of this, it's that when you try to look back on what's happened and pick out two groups, let's say masking versus no masking, but it can be for anything else, you try to make the groups similar. You control for variables like age, health, and other covariates that you think are relevant. But the problem is, especially with the masking, is that people who mask, they behave completely differently than people who don't. They may be more likely to stay home, avoid interactions with people. They may be more likely to work from home. When they get sick, they may be less likely to test. And so behaviors can be very different. And this is why we need studies where people are randomly allocated to masking versus no masking and look forward into the future to see who gets infected and have the same criteria for testing. This update that I am talking about included 11 randomized control trials with 610,000 participants, and they looked at surgical masks compared to no masks, N95 masks compared to medical masks, and then hand hygiene again compared to control. The hand hygiene, once again, as you might imagine, showed benefit. Now, when they looked at surgical masks compared to no masks, there were 12 trials there. And they noted that wearing masks in the community probably makes little or no difference to the outcome of influenza-like illness or COVID-like illness to not wearing a mask. And they had moderate certainty in the evidence. They also looked at wearing masks in the community to prevent lab-documented influenza or lab-confirmed SARS-CoV-2, i.e. COVID, infection compared to not wearing a mask. And again, they found little or no difference with moderate certainty evidence. I should point out that the 95% confidence intervals here were quite wide, 0.72 to 1.42. And what that means is it's possible that there might be a 28% lower rate of infection with masking, but there could also be a 42% higher rate with masking. And the overall relative effect was 1.01, which means there was no effect of masking, and this was based on 6 randomized control trials with 13,919 participants. The harms of masking, again, were rarely measured and poorly reported. Now, what did they say about the N95 versus surgical masks? They concluded that they probably make little or no difference in regards to lab-confirmed influenza infection with moderate certainty evidence. There was one single randomized trial published investigating medical and healthcare workers providing direct contact to COVID-19 patients. And the caveat in the study is that everybody got to use an N95 if there was aerosolized procedures going on with their patient. The most important point in the particular study is that there was low to moderate certainty of evidence against COVID infection comparing these two masks. And the authors of the specific study felt that surgical masks were not inferior to the N95 masks. And it's disappointing that there's low to moderate certainty of the evidence in this situation. And obviously it reduces confidence in the estimates that I'm presenting. And of course, that could have been bolstered by additional randomized studies which weren't done in healthcare workers caring for COVID patients. Now, I do want to point out that this is not an anti-masking video. I'm simply presenting the best available evidence that we have in 2023. Unfortunately, the concept of masking has become polarized, with many people saying on one hand that we just don't need any randomized trials because physics models in the lab using a robot with a mask show a reduction in aerosolized particles. The problem is that's likely not the only way there's transmission, and it's not how masks are used in the real world. As I've mentioned, people don't always wear them properly, they frequently touch the masks with their hands, and they spread their virus to their hands from their mask. They also take them off to eat and drink. Even in regard to healthcare workers, they don't wear their N95 throughout their entire shift. No healthcare worker does that. The longest I've ever worn an N95 was 2 hours, and I can tell you it was very uncomfortable, and they do leave a significant imprint on your face when you take them off. Healthcare workers also don't stay in the hospital the entire day and night. They have other interactions outside of work. Now, on the other side of the spectrum is the fact that masks do nothing, and that's not actually what the review says, because those confidence intervals around the estimate of 1 allow for decreased infection by 28%, as well as increased infection by 42%. Now, these kind of numbers with the relative risk at 1.0 in the middle, when we typically see this with an intervention in medicine, we tend to scrap that and not do any more studies, because it doesn't show any benefit. That's not what's happened with masking. And ideally, a large, well-designed randomized trial should have been done to try to improve upon these wide confidence intervals so that people would buy into the conclusion. And of course, some people would say it's unethical to do a study where half the group's randomized to masking and the other half isn't. But it's definitely not unethical, because we don't truly know that masking, particularly in the general population, is helpful, and we do want to answer the question. If it was helpful, I think that we probably would have seen this in randomized studies so far, which we haven't. As is always the case, the onus of an intervention, the onus of proof of that intervention, in this case masking, is to prove that there's a setting in which it actually works. Otherwise, there's no point in having it. For the COVID virus, this has not been shown definitively at this time in 2023 due to lack of studies. Many of us simply want to know whether masking is helpful, and more specifically, whether masking in certain situations might be helpful. I appreciate you staying till the end, and I appreciate you watching me. Get healthy and stay healthy.